Hey everybody, welcome to the next start of a build series on a fresh car that we pulled in here, one you guys haven't seen before. Before I get into that, I wanted to say one thing. Thanks for everybody that's been following along with our channel. And now is your chance, if you haven't yet, go ahead and hit that subscribe button over on our channel. Become a follower of our videos. It costs absolutely nothing. It's free. Did you know that over 50% of the people that watch our videos are actually not subscribers? So if we could get the rest of you guys to join on, it would help boost our numbers and it would give us more options and make us do more bigger things for the channel as we continue to grow. So thanks everybody for your support. Let's get into it. So what we have here is the 2003 Monte Carlo. Getting it in here, we had it stripped out for winter and now it's time to go in and start building this one. Let me show you guys what we've come across so far, and we're going to give a basic rundown of what we found about the car in this video. Rough game plan. I love to spitball my thoughts before I even start building these cars, and we'll adopt and change as we go. Getting into here, overall pretty clean car, but the rockers are gone, which is really weird with how clean the rest of this vehicle is. It is a W-body vehicle. Luckily, it does not have the typical rear strut rot out. The rear frame is not gone. That delete option hasn't happened. Did have a water leak, though. Trunk was full of water, so probably a good thing this is no longer on the road, because this thing was destined to rot out very soon. It had been, if someone would have parked this for a couple years just sitting, it would have filled full of water, would have frozen in the winter. I guarantee all the seams would have rusted out, and this would have been a very bad derby car in the rear. Speaking of bad derby cars in the rear, put this, okay, put this out of the way here. So, these cars, these Monte Carlos, they are W-bodies. It's typically your 90s or 2000s W-bodies, Luminas. They're still notorious to go down, but you can correct that. Now, with that being said, I, in my personal opinion, believe these Monte Carlos, they plow down worse than almost any other W-body I see run. Now, why is that? It could be the frame design, but I think it's also because of the interior of the trunk. So, what are we going to do to correct that? Well, we're obviously going to modify the rear bumper. Not going to leave that on. That's just going to go whoop straight down. I think we'll probably do what we've done on the Luminas in the past. Cut the middle of that bumper, whoop, toss it out, take your corners, roll that corner up, roll that corner up. That keeps uphill pressure on the frame. Also make sure we don't just push it down with that bumper rail with the way it's designed for collisions. But the biggest issue, I think, on these cars, you see, if you guys spot what I'm thinking here, you notice this back? Here's your passenger side strut tower. You see that distance from there to there? Yeah, see that? Now, just take a look over here on the driver's side. Do you see that distance? Yep, you see how much smaller. Hopefully, on camera, you guys can see the difference there. So, the driver's side, whole entire tire compartment here, the wheel well, fender well, whatever you want to call it, that tower, the strut tower, is just crazy extended into the back of this. The reason it's designed that way is most likely because of the strut and the gas tank flap being so far towards the back of the car. But I think that is one of the culprits why these cars plow down so bad. Because you only get about, 4 inches until you hit the seam of this big tub right here. And these tubs, they're notoriously strong. Usually, when you build any derby car, if you can get the rear bumper to stay up in here and go up against those tubs, it makes these cars very strong. It makes any car very strong in the back. And we've done that. We've actually done it with multiple vehicles. I think, heck, I got it sitting over here still. Still have not thrown this thing outside in the pasture. The Taurus wagon was a perfect example. We got the entire rear bumper and the entire hatch to go inside against those strut towers in the back, and it just made it a battering ram, and it stopped bending from right there on, which forced this thing to blow out at the rotten floor that we weren't aware of. So strong. So, if you get a car that's clean underneath, not going to blow the floor out, packing in against your strut towers, that's the right way to go. But, hear me out here. If this car was not notched, that means from a normal collision in a derby or on the road, the weakest point is only right here at the tip. The rest of this frame, from here all the way up to there, is not going to bend up. Because in doing so, it would have to push that instrier the whole strut tower up into your pillar, which would be this big pillar here. Not going to happen. Therefore, where does it go? The next weakest place, if it can't go up, is down. That is why, in my just thinking that it's going to go down right there because of that. It will force it. This tub will push the frame down. Where will it plow? I don't know. It might plow here at this hump. It might do it right here at the tip of this. But I have to say it's probably going to do it here in the middle section. Probably right along that tub. And if anything, probably right where that one starts is going to be the weakest point. It'll go there, down, coming across. That would put it almost right where that hump is. So how will we counter that? I have not figured that out yet. And I'm open to opinions right now. Open discussion with you guys. Has anyone ran these before? And what have you done getting them to roll up? We can notch, we can pre-bend, we can roll. The typical basic stuff for stock class derbies. I have entertained the idea of taking a hammer and just mashing the back of this in, putting big dents in it, smashing it, maybe even cupping it, as you would call it, like here, making it almost like this, like that, so it would roll. You could even take blades or torch or whatever and just cut slice out of this, like a, you could almost notch this entire area so it would bend. I don't know, would that work? I've also debated, if we don't do anything to this tower, what if we come in here and we cut a notch directly even with this piece? So right here, we notch the frame, do the exact same over here, which would probably be about right here at that dimple. We notch that, and then before we even run the derby, what if we intentionally do a massive pre-bend and we take the entire rear and roll it 90 degrees all the way up, so that bumper there is already 90 at the notch and bent up to here, so it's right next to touching that tray. That would get rid of any of this extension that would try to push downwards, and it would put the bumper in here. If we did that, we could potentially leave the bumper long and not cut it with the middle missing. Would that work? Would it still try to push down right there? I don't know. Maybe we do that and we roll it up 90 degrees and then do a small notch or dimple somewhere in here, right where that guy is. So that alleviates pressure, but we do not push it up at that point. We just let it roll at the first one and then run the derby and see if it bends there. Maybe. This is the part I like with the fresh part of a car. I love to strip a car out, and before I do anything, we do these assessments. You walk around, you hypothetically look for problems, you try to figure out what the car is going to do by itself before you ever do anything to change that. And your goal is to correct that. That's what we love about derbying. We love cars bending. We love the weird things to do with them. Now, obviously, if you ran mod cars, the solution to most anything is plates and welding and reinforcing. But when you run stock class, it's a little more fun. It's a little more of a challenge because you got to figure out how to get the car to do what you want without just blatantly adding metal. So I think that's what I'm going to do. I think I want to notch it. I think I want to roll it. I think I want to roll it up to that tower. I don't know. You guys give me some thoughts. See what you think. And we'll come back to this trunk. Reassess that concept. Also, don't know what we're going to do with the trunk lid. Leave it on, tuck it, fold it, throw it away. I don't know. We can go ask someone's mom and see what they think. We're getting away from the trunk. Let's work our way to the vehicle. Interior, pretty generic, typical. Ooh, catching a fender there. Yep, okay, easy. This door doesn't like to stay open. The hinges are protesting. This thing just shuts itself. So we've taken out the interior. Seats out, back seats out. Kind of as far as I'm going to go with stripping it. Could I take the carpet out? If I really want to. As many cars as we're building, anytime I stop stripping, it saves me time because I have so much more other work that's more important. Honestly, I've been leaving the carpet in most of our vehicles. Just leave it, throw in the cage, and move on. I usually take water and just splash it all over the carpet the day that I weld the cage in so nothing catches on fire, and it's been perfectly fine. Otherwise, it's clean in here. Floors are solid, seams along them, back wheel wells good, have not rotted out like your luminas would do yet, so that's good news. This does have a floor shifter, so that's cool. Susan will love that. If I haven't mentioned it yet, this is probably a good time to point it out. I think Susan's going to be running this car, I think. She's the one that's fond of the W bodies, and I think based on where we're running this car, it will be one of the shows she's going to be driving in, not me. With that being said, this car, I already know the rules for this car. I already know what they're going to be. So some of the other cars I want to run, I don't know the rules yet, so I can't start building them. That is why we started on this car first. The rules are out. I know what I'm going to do. Get going on it right away. And as we wait for delays on the other cars, we'll come around to them. When will this car run? I don't know. Couldn't tell you. There's multiple shows. As long as we get it built to the rules, we can pick one that we have open. Here is the old rocker rust. That's gone. If you haven't seen there, it's already falling all over the floor. But like I've said, the frame is solid. Don't know the story behind that, why it would do that. But let's see if I can show you guys the rear frame. As far as I know, I am yet to find a rust hole anywhere on that rear frame. You see how clean that is? Going all the way back. It's good. There's the bottom part going down and around. Hard to see, but hopefully you got the picture. Working our way to the front of the car. What are my thoughts on this? Well, first off, this is a 3400 engine. This will be my first 3400 engine we ran in a derby. All the other W body era vehicles have been mostly 3100s, with the exception of the 1 3800 that we ran on the pavement derby, which, by the way, so far, 3800, that one, that's been the best one I've liked so far. Seemed to handle heat much better, way more power. So let's see what the 34 will do for us. As far as everything under the hood, I mean, it's basically alumina. Very, very similar. You got your frame rails, they're box rails. You got your crush boxes on the top. Core support, very identical to alumina. The only difference is the newer you go with the W bodies, the sharper of an angle the core support tips back. So like alumina core supports are more like this. These early 2000s are like this. And then when you get to the Impalas, they're like that. They really change the angle on them things. I don't know why, but that's just the way they design them. So other than that, what else is different? Still has the top motor mounts. Very common for the W body vehicles. These are metal, so they're good ones to keep. And more importantly, something I have noticed is different on vehicles. This here, this mounting bar to the motor for the top motor mounts, this is steel. This one, this is steel. That is not the case on all W-body vehicles. I don't know certain places made them different, certain engines or what the case, but I have come across several where they are aluminum. Right here can be aluminum, especially right here. I've seen that be aluminum, and they will notoriously just snap off, even if these are good steel supports. So the fact this one has all of that steel is good news, means maybe I will keep those brackets when we destroy this car and get it sent to the junkyard. Those would be good to swap out with future ones. Other than that, everything else on your pulley system is identical. Alternator in the back. Got your water pump, power steering, air conditioning, all the good stuff in the exact same order. Now, electrical is just a little bit different. We did have the computer, which is right here, kind of just hanging out right now. This guy was in the airbox right here. Got to be careful, because you can't just grab the airbox and rip that bad boy right out of this car. We almost made that mistake. I was going to grab it. I'm like, man, this airbox is really heavy, and there's this massive bundle of wires that's not letting it go. So we followed those, found the computer inside of there. So took that out. It will get moved somewhere safe. That's cool. What wiring needs moved? Very little, from what I could tell. Honestly, here is... I have not moved any wires, by the way, guys. From what you see here, all I did was take the car parts off this thing. So this bundle of wires comes through your passenger side headlight, runs right up here. Probably isn't needed, to be honest. Right here is the disconnecting plug. These are ground wires, probably ground wires for the lights, for the horns, for the airbag systems we unplugged, the little sensors that are up here. I'm guessing they're not needed. Obviously, I'm not going to touch it until I'm ready to start the car back up, so we'll find out then. But I think I can undo that and take this entire bundle, pull them right back through here. Remember, do not cut them off. Do not. If you have any vehicle from 2000 or newer, don't cut a single wire. I wouldn't even cut a wire in the 90s. It is so risky that you can trigger security from the stupidest little things on these cars. And the newer vehicles you get, it is so hard to get back into them. If you do security, you got dealer issues or programming issues. Some of them need resets. And, oh, it gets into a nightmare the worse you get into it. So, I personally have never once triggered security on a vehicle. A couple times I thought I did, but it was just sensor problems. So, and the reason for that is I have never cut a wire, ever, on a car. I always just unplug them and move them. And if you accidentally trigger security while unplugging, then it's easy because you can plug it back in and it says, hey, it's working again. It's also why we don't pull the dash out of any cars. Radio, cluster, all of that must stay. So we will pull these wires in. We'll get them in here. Here's another feller that's just hanging out. These were the two wires that plugged into the electric fans right down there that we obviously removed. And then we have our fuse boxes right here on the strut tower. Not a good place to leave them. I guarantee they'll break loose. They will shoot sideways into your pulleys and pretty much shred themselves until the pulleys eat all of your fuses. That will shut a car down very quick. So, this to me seems like the most important thing to move. I've got it loose. It's hanging out right now. There's the bundle of wires that go to it down there. Following those wires, they go right there and then they turn that way and go somewhere behind the motor. Where? I don't know because I've not taken a light and looked. To be honest, it's down low. I gotta imagine there's a connector maybe way over in that corner or in the middle that goes into the firewall. But here's the biggest difference I have found with the electrical system compared to your luminas. The luminas are notorious for one major problem right next to the alternators. Do you guys know what that is? It's the wiring harness. Normally, this big bundle will plug in right there on your firewall. And sorry, I think I just ate a leaf. So what happens very notoriously on these older luminas, when the subframe and the unibody frame are all noses up, it will push this motor backwards into the firewall. In doing so, that alternator will push into the firewall, and this pulley right here will be spinning, and it will basically be a giant death wheel of RPM, and it will just go right back into that harness, and it will slowly, one by one, keep clipping through every wire that goes into that firewall until either A, catches on fire, or B, kills something important and the motor shuts down. Very common problem. So, that's something I do like, looking at the wiring harness for this. Is that because this is a 3400, or is it because this is the newer generation W-body with the aluminum subframes? I don't know. We'll have to run another one to find out, I suppose. But I like that a lot. That's going to keep this very simple. Honestly, once we pull the windshield out, I will probably hack open a spot right here, take this bad boy, jam it right in there, spray foam, bag, covering it with a floor mat, all that fun stuff. The wiring harness we can suck in, probably undo this cross brace. I want to leave it for the derby, but we could pull that harness straight up right here in this hole. We'll cut some of this metal out of the way, no sharp edges. Learned our lesson on that. And put the wires right through here and connect it where that fuse block will sit. I think that would be a simple process. And to be honest, based on the wires, I don't think there would be much wiring that crosses that way to give us a problem to stop us from moving that fuse box. That seems pretty simple. Then the only other thing to move is going to be this lovely computer, which will be a little bit more of a struggle because it has two different pigtails. One of them goes on top of the motor. That's good. That's easy to clip off and move straight to the firewall. But that one there runs along the front of the motor to the starter. That's important. And then back to your transmission, also important. So the computer, just hypothetically thinking right now on the spot, maybe we take it and we tuck it right under there in between the brake booster and that strut tower. It's a good spot of mine. I like to just jam stuff in there, bury it in spray foam. These wiring harnesses should reach that corner. I don't foresee a major problem. That's my thoughts right now, and that's what we're sticking with. No, I'm just kidding. I'll probably change my mind about two or three times as we're building this car until I settle down on what I truly like with stuff like that. there is our assessment on the Monte Carlo. Now that we've gone through and planned it all out in our heads, let's put it all into action. And I'm going to wait on the trunk. I'm going to probably start on the front of this thing and work my way backwards. And also pay attention at some point to figuring out our subframe, aluminum, and whatnot. And we do need to also get the wheel plan figured out now that we're looking at this. We'll switch out those aluminum knuckles to steel spindles. And this car came with factory 16-inch tires. I don't know if 15s will fit. I think we'll have to do the old Taurus trick. If you guys have watched my video, I specifically show you how to make tires fit. Like, if you have a car that has 16 or 17-inch rims, I show you exactly how to make a 15-inch steel rim or whatever rim fit onto here without much work. You just gotta grind down these calipers and take some chunks out of them. We'll use some old spray paint. We'll do that trick. That should get me some tires on the front of this, get this thing rolling around. So, there we have it. First start, episode one on the build series. Check it out. We'll come back to this in episode two and see what progress we have done.